this is the WhamBam Mutant, patent pending. You just saw what it does. It's a quick change system for 3D printers and light duty CNCs, be it with a routing head or something like a laser. You have one part that stays on the machine, they're calling this the fixed plate, and one part that stays with the tool head, that's the mobile plate. And they lock together with a pretty simple but effective mechanism. They slide together with a dovetail, and then it's this lever that locks it all in place. You know, the sliding action actually kind of reminds me of Game Boy cartridges. Just that, you know, when these are in place, they are a lot more solid. So the first thing I'm wondering is, okay, why aren't you subscribed yet? Like, two-thirds of you are watching, but aren't subscribed, so just do it, okay? You know, click the button. Where is it? Somewhere down there, I think. Thanks. Okay, but what I was really wondering is, you know, the Mutant is something entirely different than what the E3D Toolchanger and also the Exchange that's currently on Kickstarter is doing. So why do it like this? Quick refresher. The Toolchanger has a more planar mount that uses hardened steel mates and a little bayonet grabber that pulls it all tight. And that system is optimized for being able to automatically swap tools during a print, so that planar coupling is really a result of having to do the docking and grabbing by using the motion the printer can already handle. So something like this, you know, just wouldn't have worked for that. Because WhamBam did not have to account for that use case and made this a 100% manual changeover procedure, this mount actually does a lot more than the tool changer. You might have already seen it, but this one has an electrical quick change as well. So you hook up your printer's wiring loom into the base plate and then wire your hot end, your sensor and all that only to the mobile plate. So this is all attached just to the plate right here. The locking lever actually does double duty, not just as a locking feature, but also as a release lever. You can see that down here where it actually pushes apart the two plates when you try to release them. The connector they're using for the electrical connection is a fairly standard pin header type with a 2mm pitch, and those take a bit of force not just to plug in, but also to separate again. You know, if you've ever tried to pull apart a RAMS and an Arduino Mega, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about. The official ratings for these terminals is 2.6 amp each for these 12 lower rated contacts, and then 10 amps for the separate pair. Which is interesting, because the 2.6 amp terminals use one pin each on the pin header, but the 10 amp terminal uses three, which means it's actually pushing 3.3 amps per pin on the header. Of course, I just had to test that 10 amp claim, so because I don't have a 10 amp lab power supply, I just used a heated bed, wired it through the Mutant plates, and adjusted the voltage on the power supply until I got roughly 10 amps. Okay, 11, but this will drop down super quickly once everything heats up. Metals like copper have a much higher resistance once they're hot. And heat up things did. Now, the Mutant's parts actually seemed totally fine, but because the terminals are so tiny, you can only use fairly thin wiring, which will in turn heat up much more than everything else in the system. So that is actually going to be the limiting factor. I still wouldn't want to push a continuous 10 amps through this, but for a hot end, you know, that just needs to heat up once and then maintain temperature, or even something like a small router spindle, this will be more than adequate. As far as voltage goes, I think these connectors, both the screw terminals and the pin header, can officially take a couple hundred volts. But I would call it quits at 48 volt DC, and I would definitely not hook up mains to it, even though the connectors theoretically can handle it. Because, well, you know, all the connections are exposed, at least when you remove the mobile plate. 48 volt is going to be a bit of a tingle, but generally still considered safe. There's also no pre-shut off or any means to turn off your high current load, you know, as you disconnect. So in case that you, you know, disconnect a router spindle or even a high powered hot end while it's still powered up, you might get some arcing across the header from the first to the second one. Of course, you also need to manually turn off any stepper motors that are routed through the Mutant before you disconnect it, because stepper drivers don't really like it when you just yank the connections apart. As far as the firmware knowing that you've swapped something, well, that's up to you to figure out. The easiest way to do it would be just to stick with one type of thermistor for every hot end for every tool you put on here, and then mounting the bed probe directly to the mobile plate, which basically is going to take care of different length hot ends like a volcano or something. Where is that? There's my super volcano on a Hemera. The finer adjustment, both in height and in printing settings, can then be done through the slicer with simply a different profile for each tool head, which you're going to need anyways to account for the actually chained tool that you've just mounted. There's also support in Marlin for tool changing, but that's something you're going to have to configure yourself. As for the mechanical parts, they're all, you know, an injection molded glass fiber reinforced nylon plastic, which is solid, but the parts don't feel like super high quality. I mean, they're robust and all, but they've all got pretty sharp flashing edges, and most of these parts are actually kind of crooked because of the way that they're designed. It's just big slabs of plastic, and as you all know, plastic, when it cools down, likes to warp a good bit, especially right after it's molded, when the entire part is still hot and deformable. So you get things like a bent release lever. You can kind of see that hopefully right there. The mobile and fixed plates are crooked and they line up with a very ugly gap, which thankfully doesn't seem to affect how the connector engages. There is sink marks all over the surface of the mobile plate. They're probably a couple tenths. And worst of all, if you look at the strain relief on the fixed plate, it doesn't line up with the cover. I mean, the parts certainly aren't pretty, but they work. They all fit together well and they do their job. So for actually mounting the fixed and mobile plates to a printer and a tool head to the mobile plate, you are going to need an adapter for almost every situation. Thankfully, the Mutant system has been out with volunteer beta testers, and they have already designed tons of mounting parts, both for adapting the plates to printer carriages, as well as the mobile plates to extruders and hot ends. The mobile plate has a ton of different spacings, but the only direct match that I could find without using an adapter was for the Creality hot end fitting these two bottom holes here, basically. The full Hemera has a mounting space of 34 millimeters. The plate has a 32 millimeter pattern here. So it's close, but it doesn't quite fit. But you can actually directly mount a Slice Engineering Mosquito, but it's in the slightly wrong orientation. I guess this section over here is meant to mount bed leveling sensors, but again, you will need some sort of an adapter. The extra layers of plates and mounts and adapters will mean that your tool head is going to keep sticking out further and further the more plates you add as adapters. The Mutant base is 12 millimeters thick, but with a couple of adapter layers that easily gets bumped to 20 or 25 millimeters. I kind of wish these mounting holes on the mobile plate were all just slots. That way they would directly cover a much wider range of mounting patterns. But thankfully, because this is such a solid slab of plastic, instead of being hyper-optimized for injection molding and weight by using ribs, you can definitely just drill your own mounting pattern into it. The pattern that comes stock has pockets for M3 hex nuts in the back. I think square nuts would have been nicer as they would also work better with slots, but you can use these pockets both with a nut to basically screw into the plate, or you can stick a cap head screw in the back and screw into a hot end or extruder that already has threads in it. It's similar on the fixed plate, but you only get four holes to mount it. You can drill your own, but by default, this didn't directly fit any printers I have. WhamBam do offer custom carriages that directly fit the Mutant for both linear rail setups, as well as V-wheel setups like, you know, on the Ender 3 or all the Ender 3 lookalikes, which simply replaces your entire carriages and provides belt clamping and the mounting points for the Mutant's fixed plate. Very chunky and solid. The general idea, though, is to use adapters for the fixed and the mobile plates. You can grab those from Thingiverse and Prusa Printers. Media Man, who has designed the Hero Me system for Creality machines, has already adapted his mount to the Mutant, and you can use those for a pretty big range of hot ends already. The thing is, though, for printers that don't follow the Chinese standard, you know, 2020 extrusion for the X-axis design, mounting can be pretty awkward. For example, on the Mendel 9001 and its flat carriage, this huge hump on the back of the Mutant, it just doesn't have anywhere to go. So I need to spacer out the entire fixed plate by a good 30 millimeters just to be able to get it attached. On the Prusa Mark III, the hump is also a bit of a problem if you try to mount it too tightly against the carriage, because it's going to crash into the frame up top. And also, the Mutant is a whole lot wider than the stock setup, so you will be losing either range in the X-axis when it crashes into the X-ends, or in the Y-axis if you spacer it out so far forward that it now clears the X-ends. Okay, so the Mutant system is built for both Bowden and direct drive setups. You can get plenty of electrical connections to run a pot end, a bed sensor, an extruder, and a pair of fans from it. But with Bowden setups, your hot end is still going to be attached to the printer through the Bowden tube, which is why they are also including one of these Bowden connectors. That's supposed to release more easily than the standard brass connectors and shouldn't chew up the Bowden tube as much. It seems to work better than these cheap standard connectors, but honestly, I would still rather unscrew, this one's too tight, the connector from the extruder and just keep the length of Bowden tube attached to the tool head instead of reclamping it into the connector every single time. Especially for the kind of hot ends that use the Bowden tube as a hot end liner as well, like these standard Creality hot ends, those I would definitely adjust and set up once and then just leave them as is and undo the other end of the Bowden tube. Unless, of course, you do the mod where you split the Bowden tube and you capture a piece of that tube with a washer underneath the Bowden connector. One more thing before we get to the price is the fact that, you know, this system is patent pending. If you want the full version of why I am not a huge fan of that, check out the latest episode of the Meltzone podcast up here. Yep. That I do with Stefan from CNC Kitchen. But short version. So far, patents in 3D printing have served mostly to lock away features that would actually be useful. You know, belt printers are built with that awkward 45 degree angle because MakerBot and now Stratasys hold the patent on building them like a normal machine. We can't really print PEK or to an extent even ABS well because properly heated chambers are locked behind a patent too. I mean, the only reason why we have FDM printers, filament-based 3D printers, from anyone other than Stratasys is because the patent they held on the core process expired in 2009, which then spawned the entire rep-rep movement. You know, what I'm afraid is going to happen, or possibly is already happening, is that innovating in the 3D printing space is going to turn into a legal minefield of patents that you're just going to have to navigate around somehow. And in the end, people trying to build new things will have to spend more engineering time building clumsy workarounds to avoid proven patented solutions than actually innovating. Now, I don't know which details of the Mutant will be covered by patents since they're not public yet, but in general, I'm just not a huge fan of where this is heading. That's actually the same for the competing exchange as well. Okay, let's get to the price. There are two different packages available for the WhamBam Mutant. The base kit with just one fixed plate and one mobile plate, plus accessories, for $85 plus tax, shipping, etc. And then the quad kit, which, as the name implies, comes with three mobile plates for $149. You can also buy the fixed and mobile plate separately, as well as the pneumatic couplers and the optional, you know, adapterless gantries. To me, all the Mutant parts are not as cheap as I was hoping they would be, but most of the cost is just going to be down to the relatively small scale manufacturing for accessories like these. The folks that are really going to benefit from having a quick change system on their 3D printer, I mean, you guys will already know you want one, and, you know, for you, this absolutely makes sense. But, you know, here's two things that I would like to consider before you head out and buy one of these. With just the base kit and, you know, just a single mobile plate, unless you print yourself extra plates for example, a pen plotter, you don't actually get a quick change system. You just get a quick, you know, removal and reinstall system. The official use case for that is, you know, being able to take the hot end and extruder off of your printer and, you know, being able to work on them outside of the machine. And I see how that's useful, but with that, you are essentially planning for failure. You're planning for having to service your toolhead as it keeps on breaking. Now, my thinking is, In that case, why not plan for success and, instead of a quick change system, invest in something like a Himera and just put it on without any plates, which is simply not going to need as much servicing, so that now there's no reason for you to actually take it off the printer. Maybe don't get the Super Volcano as your first Himera, though. And for the price of the quad, you can basically get yourself a whole new Ender 3, an extra Ender 3, and have one setup for regular printing or whatever, and then have the other with a Volcano or optimized for flexibles or whatever else you would want to otherwise mount to your extra mobile plates. It also gives you twice the print capacity if that's something that matters to you. Of course, buying an extra Ender 3 just gives you two tool heads instead of three. And in, you know, both cases, you don't actually end up with a quick change system, but it's just something to consider if you want to get maximum value out of your 3D printer budget. Like I said, if you want this, you'll know it. I'm just really happy that quick change systems are something that is being adopted and being made available. More options is always a good thing. Now, I'm not going to be using the Mutant on my main productive printers, like my Prusa or the testing platform, the Mendel 9001, because for both of those, it means butchering at least the wiring job and limiting the machines because the Mutant isn't totally compatible with them, just by the way that it's mounted. But on the Ender 3, it fits in a lot better. You know, my Ender 3 has been sitting mostly dormant because, well, if I wanted to print something, I always had better printers to do it on. But I think this is a nice add-on to extend what I can now use it for. At the end of the day, the Mutant hardware certainly is not the flashiest or most drool-worthy piece of kit, but it's functional and it does the job well that it was designed to do. It's easy to use, it's robust, it's electrically decent. I mean, it's not a super complex piece of hardware, but there are still a lot of details that it could mess up. Now, like I said, I wish a couple things were different, but this is fine. And if you have a proper use case for a quick change system like this, then surely the price point will make sense to you. So I hope that gave you a good overview of the WhamBam Mutant system. You can find the links to all this in the description below. If you found the video helpful, I would much appreciate a like on the video, get subscribed. But in either case, I would like to know from you guys, is this system something that you're interested in? And if so, what would you use it for? Leave me a comment below. If you want to support the channel directly, you can do so from. If you want to support the channel directly, you can do so through YouTube memberships and on Patreon. Thank you for watching, keep on making, and I will see you in the next one.